By Donald Trump. In the author's copy of The Art of the Deal. To George. There is no one like you. Only you and I know how important a role you played in my success. Thanks for everything. Best wishes. Donald Trump. Xi. Preface. They spent 50 years as a lawyer, business advisor, and deal negotiator for real estate tycoons at the top of the world's toughest real estate market, New York City. I've represented or negotiated with great real estate minds like Harry Helmsley, Sam Lefrak, Bill Zeckendorf, and Donald Trump. It's been my good fortune to spend many of the best years of my career as Donald's right-hand man. These days most people know me best from the TV show, The Apprentice, where Carolyn Koepcher and I help Donald make tough decisions about whom to fire and whom to keep. The show has been fun, but most of my work for Donald over the past 25 years has been in the world of real estate. I have been an advisor, negotiator, and lawyer on many of his biggest and most successful real estate investments, including the acquisition and renovation of the GM building, Trump Tower on Fifth Avenue, the Grand Hyatt Hotel, and my personal favorite, 40 Wall Street. Throughout my career, I have had the opportunity to acquire a great deal of knowledge and experience in real estate investing, which I hope to pass on to you in this book. For example, during a 10-year period from 1956 to 1966 when Saul Goldman and Alex DiLorenzo Jr. became two of the biggest property owners in New York, I personally bought 702 individual properties on their behalf. I have been intimately involved in many of New York City's most spectacular projects, such as the Chrysler Building and the St. Regis Hotel, which I helped one of my clients buy. I've also had the opportunity to watch Donald Trump in action as he made some of the greatest real estate investments in history. This book explains the strategies Donald Trump used to make his real estate fortune, and how small investors can apply them to investments of any size, right down to a one-family rental property. I describe how Trump implements some of his signature strategies such as creating luxury, perceived value, exclusivity, and attention to detail, which all come together to maximize the value of his investments. This is why his properties earn far more money, square foot for square foot, than his competitors. A number of the chapters focus on a particular real estate investment that I was directly involved in negotiating or advising Trump on. Using this example, I draw out the lessons and explain how the same strategies that Trump used to make huge profits on his deals can work for you, the small investor. Although Trump does things on a grand scale and his target market is usually an elite, luxury customer, Trump's basic real estate strategies will be of interest to anyone who is interested in owning or developing real estate. Anyone unsure of how to negotiate a real estate transaction. Anyone who is in real estate on a small scale but would like to do more. Anyone interested in learning how Donald Trump does his magic. This is the first book on Trump's strategies for the real estate investor. Although it has a lot of nuts and bolts guidance and investing principles, the book alone will not make you a great investor. As I tell the students who take my negotiation course at New York University, there's no way in 15 hours that I can make you. An excellent negotiator. It is impossible. All I want to do is open your mind to the possibilities and the power of negotiating, and some basic techniques. Then, when you run into a specific situation, you can go back to your notes and say, how did George handle this? Or, what did he suggest? You already have some ideas about real estate, but I've learned many things in my 25 years working with Trump and 50 years in the real estate business that I'd like to pass along to you. If I am successful, this book will help you negotiate far better deals, arrange better financing, make better investments, and earn significantly more money in real estate. I recall the day I first met Donald Trump in 1974. He entered my office at the law firm of Dreyer & Traub beaming with enthusiasm about a project he wanted to do with the old Commodore Hotel on 42D Street in New York City. He was just 27 years old at the time, and I was a senior partner known for completing complex deals, but I agreed to see him out of courtesy because I represented his father, Fred Trump. Fred had spoken enthusiastically about Donald's promise as a future star in the real estate world. Donald laid out his incredibly complex plan for buying the huge, dumpy, rundown hotel next to Grand Central Station and turning it into a first-class, state-of-the-art business hotel. I told him it was a brilliant idea, but there was no way it would ever work, given the number of powerful people and governmental agencies he would have to convince to grant him major concessions. Nevertheless, if he was willing to pay the legal fees, I was willing to help him take a shot at it. We spent the next 2 years negotiating with railroad executives, city and state officials, lenders, and Hyatt executives making the deal happen. During those tumultuous 2 years, Donald and I developed a great working relationship and mutual respect. When he miraculously pulled off the deal, I was so sure he would be a huge success in real estate that I became his closest advisor and lawyer. She. H-O-M-Y-C-A-R-E-E-R-S started. W. Hen, I was young, growing up in Brooklyn, New York. I planned to go to MIT to be an engineer, but my father died suddenly when I was 16 and that plan died with him. At 17 I enlisted in the U.S. Army because they offered to send me to college. When I went on active duty, I was trained as a crypt analyst, a code breaker, and spent most of my short Army career in Washington, D.C. The analytical skills, patience, and tenacity I learned as a code breaker helped me when I was faced with seemingly unresolvable real estate problems. With the help of the GI Bill, I obtained my BA degree at Brooklyn College and entered Brooklyn Law School. Working three jobs concurrently and with the support of my working wife, I graduated and was admitted to the New York Bar in 1953. While looking for a job, I saw an ad in the Law Journal for a law clerk. As luck would have it, the person who answered the phone was Bill, a friend from law school. He was working for Dreyer & Traub, a well-known real estate law firm. Bill said, "You don't want this job. You'll be nothing but a messenger and it only pays $25 a week." But I took it anyway. That was the inauspicious beginning of my legal career. Although Dreyer & Traub was a law firm dealing primarily with real estate matters, they handled litigation as a courtesy for their clients, and Bill and I worked in the litigation department. Several months later there was an opening upstairs in the real estate acquisition and leasing practice, the place where real money was made. It was an excellent opportunity for advancement and Bill was slotted for the job. I was to take his spot in litigation. But before he could start, he was drafted into the Army and recommended me for the real estate position. Once upstairs, I had the good fortune to apprentice to Murray Felton, a very tough taskmaster. He was so demanding that if I put a comma in the wrong place, I would hear about it for days. But Felton was a superb technician and highly regarded in the XIV world of real estate attorneys. I knew that working with him was a great opportunity to learn the intricacies of real estate law from a perfectionist. So I soaked up every bit of helpful information I could from him. I became adept at drafting leases, real estate documents, and participating in all types of transactions. My prior litigation experience added to the perception that I was a competent, though young, real estate attorney. L. Earning the REAL Estate B. Usiness. In 1955, one of my clients asked me to draft a commercial lease for him even though he was to be the tenant. Usually, the landlord's attorney drafts the lease, but in this case the landlord told my client to have his lawyer prepare the lease. So I drew up the lease and inserted a provision stating that the tenant didn't have to pay any rent before the landlord made a certain elevator operational. My client moved in and, as it turned out, the elevator inspector for New York City refused to accept the elevator repairs the landlord made, insisting that only a brand new elevator would get his approval. The elevator stayed out of operation for a very long time. But throughout that period my client was still able to carry out his normal business operations. The owners, Saul Goldman and Alex DiLorenzo Jr. had a tenant in possession, utilizing the premises for its normal business operations, but because of that clause in the lease, the tenant was not paying them any rent. Although the landlords were very unhappy, they were helpless. In the mid-1950s, Goldman and DiLorenzo, who were both multimillionaires, had decided to invest in real estate on a huge scale. I had decided to leave Dreyer and Traub because I had been told that there was no possibility for me to become a partner in the firm. I happened to mention my impending departure to Saul Goldman and XV. He called me a few days later and said, "George, Alex and I would like you to be our counsel." I said, "Why me?" He said, "Well, we already paid $90,000 in the form of lost rent just for the privilege of knowing you. We'll make it worth your while if you say yes." I accepted their offer. E. Very pages Roblem H's AP Rice TAG. Very quickly I learned something that every real estate investor should understand. There is a huge difference between the legal aspects of real estate and the business of investing in real estate. I had to restructure my whole way of thinking. Whenever I discovered a legal problem with a real estate deal, Goldman would say, "Is it serious enough to blow the deal?" If I said, "No," then he would say, "How much can I get off the price for the problem?" Most lawyers simply advise their clients not to do a deal if they find legal problems. Lawyers cannot or will not make business recommendations for their clients. Goldman forced me to think like a businessman, not just a lawyer, and realize that almost every problem has a price tag. He forced me to look at legal problems strictly as a way of improving the deal. He'd say, "What can I get if I overlook this problem?" To find that answer, I had to dig into the problem. For example, Goldman and DiLorenzo contracted to buy Harborside Terminal in Jersey City, New Jersey, from the railroad that owned it. The property consisted of a huge cold storage warehouse of almost 2 million square feet abutting the Hudson River, right across the river from downtown Manhattan. The purchase price seemed reasonable even though it was to be an all-cash deal. However, the title report contained an exception for possible claims of the state of New Jersey to a strip of land that the warehouse straddled. It became clear to me why the railroad was having difficulty finding a XVI buyer. No lawyer would let a client buy the property with such a defect, and certainly no bank would place a mortgage on it. The problem related to land underwater that was filled in sometime in the 1800s. A law was passed stipulating that if the land underwater was filled in by the adjoining landowner before 1849, the landowner had good title to it. If it was filled in after 1849, the state of New Jersey owned it. I couldn't prove when it was filled in and who filled it, nor could the state of New Jersey. I told Saul we should get a price reduction and also convince the railroad to take back a long-term purchase money mortgage at a low interest rate, since no lender would make any loan because of the title defect. The railroad agreed to reduce the purchase price by $400,000 and to take a sizable mortgage, so we closed the deal. Several years went by, but the title impediment still stuck in my craw. I was certain that the state of New Jersey must have encountered the same problem in the past, since much of the land abutting the Hudson River was filled in land. I contacted the state and learned that they were aware of the problem, and rather than sit with a dubious claim, they had passed a statute giving the state the right to give up its claim in exchange for the value of their interest in the disputed land. Following the procedure outlined in the statute, we paid a minimal amount and received a quitclaim deed to the land in dispute from the state of New Jersey. As a result, the property appreciated in value so much that a bank made a first mortgage loan in an amount exceeding the total purchase price paid by Goldman and DiLorenzo. From 1956 to 1966, Goldman and DiLorenzo were New York real estate. When I arrived at Goldman and DiLorenzo in 1956, they owned 18 properties. When I left in 1966, they owned 720. I negotiated and handled almost all of these purchases by myself with very little supervision from them. We were buying Manhattan ground leases by the dozen, warehouses in New York Harbor, and multi-million dollar office buildings. We were dealing in big numbers, and much of XVII. It was done with cash. Many times I walked into a closing on a property with a certified check for millions of dollars in my wallet. I was also given a standing million-dollar deposit by Goldman and DiLorenzo with which to negotiate. Goldman and DiLorenzo would tell me what type of deal they wanted, and my job was to make it happen. They were not anxious buyers, so if I didn't think the deal met their terms, I would kill it and go on to the next one. That's what enabled them to acquire so much real estate so quickly. During that 10-year period, I bought the Chrysler Building, the St. Regis Hotel, the land under the Plaza Hotel, Harborside Terminal in Jersey City, and numerous ground leases on their behalf. A ground lease is a long-term lease for land on which a building sits, and gives the tenant all the rights and obligations of operation and ownership except title to the land. Goldman and DiLorenzo's appetite for real estate was voracious. They had excellent financing connections which enabled me to close transactions quickly. As their loan lawyer and business representative, I had almost unlimited authority to negotiate but not to increase the purchase price. I negotiated with Harry Helmsley, Bill Zeckendorf, and Morris Karp to name a few. These were all the big names in New York real estate at that particular time, pretty heady stuff for a 30-year-old lawyer. For the first few years I worked for Goldman and DiLorenzo, I was in way over my head. At Dreyer and Traub, I was handling closings on single-family homes in New Jersey. I had never done a contract and closing on any office building of any size. Now I was thrust into an arena involving the purchase and operation of huge office buildings. I really had no prior training or experience. Yet everyone thought, because I was so young and represented these millionaires in huge transactions, I must be brilliant, so they treated me as an equal. I knew how green I was, but I wasn't going to dispute their assessment of me. I learned as fast as I could from everyone I XVIII. Came in contact with, including all the people on the other side, the lawyers and other professionals and the real estate moguls themselves. I concentrated on what they did, how they did it, how they acted and reacted in certain situations, and anything else that would fill the void of my ineptitude. I was like a sponge absorbing every bit of information I could. Before long, my crash course in real estate paid off and I began to give my clients well-reasoned opinions as to which deals were good and which were not and what price to pay. This gave me a unique combination of talents. Most lawyers don't know the business of real estate, and therefore, they are not equipped to make business decisions. They are ready to render advice on any legal issue, but leave the business decisions to their client. RADIOS. Any good lawyer will make lots of money while practicing law, but since lawyering is a service business, the income stops when you step down. I recognize the need to invest in some enterprise that would be of value in my later years. In 1966, my brother-in-law, Martin Beck, was leaving the Katz Agency, a big name in the business of selling radio time. He suggested that we look for investment opportunities together. He thought radio broadcasting on Long Island would be profitable. I told him, I don't know anything about the radio business. He said, I know all about radio but I don't know how to raise the capital necessary for a venture. I told him, you find and run the stations and I'll find the money to make it happen. In 1966, we formed Beck Ross Communications Corporation and bought our first radio station in Long Island, WGLI, for approximately $450,000. Marty knew how to make money in radio broadcasting. Using the profits from WGLI and by expanding our financial contacts, we 6. Embarked on a plan of expansion. FM broadcasting was in its infancy, but the superiority of the sound made it an attractive prospect. We purchased several other stations, both AM and FM, increased their market share, and then sold them at huge profits. In 1986, Marty and I bought out all of our investors for 25 times their original investment. In 1987, we were faced with a decision that many investors confront at some time, to expand the business or sell out to someone who would. We chose to take a substantial profit and leave the expansion to the buyer. But the radio business was only a sideline to my law career. In 1966, after 10 years with Goldman and DiLorenzo, my reputation had grown to the point where I could have received a partnership with any quality law firm with a real estate department. I opted to return as a partner to my old firm, Dreyer & Traub, where I was being accepted as a senior partner. I realized that since only two young attorneys had become new partners in the past 10 years and the old partners were reaching retirement, it would be my firm within a few years. That's exactly what happened. By the early 1970s, I became one of four senior partners running one of the best real estate law firms in New York with as many as 120 lawyers. I led that firm for more than 20 years. Eventually, I got tired of dealing with partnership politics, gave up the active practice of law, got a severance package, and joined the Edward S. Gordon Company, where my role for the next 10 years was to supply real estate expertise to major clients like United Technologies, IBM, The New York Times, and AT&T. HOIC aimed to WORK for DONALDT Rump. Although I left the active practice of law in 1987, I remained friendly with Donald Trump, and though I had worked with him on many of his most successful projects, I was no longer his lawyer. When the New York City real estate market tanked in 1990, Trump hit the rocks. It was not due to a lack of business acumen, rather, his phenomenal success had created an air of invincibility. Because he had been so incredibly successful, he began to think that any business he touched would turn to gold. The banks would throw money at him. If he asked to borrow $60 million for a building, they gave him $80 million. When the bottom fell out of the New York City real estate market, he was vastly overextended and was over $990 million in debt. He owed so much money that the lenders knew if they forced him into bankruptcy, it would have a disastrous effect on the real estate market. They had many bad loans that they didn't want to write off. So they came up with a plan that would enable him to work his way back by agreeing to accept a substantial reduction if the loans were repaid by a certain future date. Even though I was no longer a member of a law firm, I wanted to help. I told Donald that if he ever needed legal advice or counsel while he was in trouble, I would be happy to do it for him without charge. He was impressed and asked me why I would do that. I said, "Donald, I think a lawyer has a responsibility to represent a client when he's down, not only when he's on top. I'm here if you need me." Trump never accepted my offer because it's not his style to get something for nothing. But I'm sure he appreciated the gesture. My philosophy has since paid off in spades. With Donald Trump, loyalty goes a long way. In the mid-1990s, Donald had two deals going, the new Nike building adjoining Trump Tower and 40 Wall Street. Both were plagued with problems because of the lawyers involved, and very little was getting accomplished. Donald knows when to use delay tactics, but he also hates deals that drag on and on. So he hired me to eliminate the roadblocks and get those deals done. W. Heil I was. XXI. Working on them, I told Donald that I was bored with my life at Gordon and was planning to retire. He asked me to join the Trump organization on a full-time basis. He said, "I've got a lot of great things going and you'll have fun." We quickly agreed on terms. I only work 4 days a week, and 10 years later, I'm still an important part of the Trump team. My title is Senior Executive Vice President and Senior Counsel for the Trump Organization, and my primary function is to give Donald Trump business and legal advice. I offer my opinion as to the feasibility of his proposed projects, which he is free to accept or reject. He likes to bounce things off me before reaching his own decision. He knows that I will call it like I see it and give him an unbiased opinion. I'm currently responsible for developing many foreign investments for Donald and supervising the leasing and operation of 40 Wall Street and Trump Tower. Additionally, I teach a course at New York University on negotiation. Negotiation is a subject that I have made a study of throughout my career, because it is such a critical part of real estate success. I could easily fill a book on this subject. For a discussion of some of the principles and techniques used by Trump that I think are most valuable, see chapters 3 and 4. Trump has been a great man to work for. In 10 years, he has never once asked me where I'm going or what I'm doing. That's the kind of trust we have. When he gave me responsibility for 40 Wall Street, I took the building from where it was, a 1 million square foot nearly vacant structure he purchased for $1 million, to where it is now, a thriving office building worth in excess of $350 million. After 40 Wall Street had been rented and had become extremely profitable for Trump, I said to him, "I think I'm entitled to a bonus for 40 Wall Street." Trump's reply was, "How much do you think you're entitled to?" I gave him a figure. He said, "You've got it." It's this kind of recognition that makes it a pleasure to work for him. XXII. Fred Trump once said to Donald when he needed a lawyer, "You would be hard-pressed to find a wiser, more loyal, or a better advisor and lawyer than George Ross." I'm delighted Donald took that advice and gave me the opportunity to work with a true real estate genius. Now I hope to pass on to you some of the powerful investing strategies I've learned from some of the greatest real estate minds in the business. ACKNOWLEDGMENTS. My gratitude to Donald J. Trump for becoming such an important part of my life as a friend and for giving me the unique opportunity throughout my career to help turn his visions of spectacular projects into realities. Donald Trump became a billionaire in real estate by making a series of incredibly creative and successful investments in New York City properties. He is now the largest real estate developer in New York and is widely acknowledged to be one of the most brilliant real estate investing minds anywhere. For example, in the early 1980s, with the building of Trump Tower on Fifth Avenue, he single-handedly created the market for high-end luxury residences in New York City. He continued with a string of successes and in 2003, 9 of the 10 highest-selling apartments were in Trump buildings, apartments that sold for millions of dollars each. What can the small real estate investor learn from a billionaire developer like Trump? After advising Trump on many of his biggest investments over 25 years, I'm convinced that small investors can successfully use many of the same principles that earn him millions. It's not the scale of your real estate investment project that counts. Whether you are investing in a single-family rental, a four-unit rental, or a multi-million-dollar office building makes no difference to the financial success of your particular project. What's important are the real estate investing strategies used to acquire and develop the property, and how you design and market the property to buyers or tenants. Many of the same basic principles that work for one of Trump's $300 million skyscrapers work just as well for smaller properties. Anyone interested in investing in real estate can benefit from a study of Trump's real estate investor strategies. For example, you can't make big real estate investments, or really profitable small investments, without projecting certain personal qualities that inspire confidence in others, and make them want to help you or to see things your way. The key personal qualities you need are enthusiasm, relationship-building skills, showmanship, preparation, and tenacity. Donald Trump has these qualities in spades as he demonstrated on his first big real estate deal, the transformation of the dilapidated Commodore Hotel on 42nd Street in New York City into the magnificent Grand Hyatt. Remarkably, Trump used very little of his own money in this transaction, yet later sold his half interest to Hyatt for $85 million. This chapter will describe how these five key personal qualities helped Trump make the Commodore Hyatt deal work, and how small investors can use these same qualities in their own real estate investments to negotiate better deals, sell properties for more money, and dramatically improve real estate profits.
When I was young, I'd listen to the radio, waiting for my favorite songs. When they played, I'd sing along. It made me smile.